Excellency Daughter the Most Honourable Anthony Carter, Chief Omoale Cultural Ambassador of Barbados, recipient of the Clemapian Heroes Award, was born in Emerton Lane in the city. Carter was given the nickname Gabby as a child and first had success as a Calypsonian in 1968, when his heart transplant won him the title Barbados Calypso Monarch. He won the title again in 1969 with Family Planning. Rather than build on his success, he instead concentrated on acting for the next few years, joining the Barbados Theatre Workshop and composing much of the music for its play Under the Duppy Parasol, which had a successful run in New York. Gabby, as an actor, also performed in many local productions, including Jeanette Lane Clark's Pampalam, and represented Barbados internationally.
He returned to music and crowning full success in 1976, his late slate player giving him the first of a string of victories at Crop Over. He was awarded the Folk Singer of the Year for three successive years from 1977 to 1979. Fisherman. In 1979, he won the Crop Over Road March title with Burn Mr. Harding and went on to tour Cuba.
Gabby courted controversy in 1985 with cadavers, a commentary on the Barbados government's decision to allow dead bodies from the U.S. to be stored on the island. He was sued by the government, but Prime Minister Tom Adams died before the case came to court, and the plan was subsequently shelved.
He continued to produce controversial material, including The List, which dealt with AIDS, Jack, which criticized the local tourist industry for giving preferential treatment to foreign visitors, and Boots, an attack on government assistance in the U.S. invasion of Grenada. He won the Calypso Monarch title for a third time in 1985 with West Indian politician.
In the late 1980s, he began an association with the singer and producer Eddie Grant, who owned the Blue Wave Studio, helping to break through to a wider audience. He won the Calypso Monarch title on four more occasions in 1997, 1999, 2000, and 2010. In 2004, he was named Cultural Ambassador of Barbados.
In 2007, Gabby was named a Nigerian chief in the service at the Sons of God Apostolic Spiritual Baptist Church in Ile Grove, Christchurch, Barbados. Gabby, who had recently visited Nigeria, was given the name Omowale, which means our son has returned. The service was also to coincide with the United Nations designated Black Civilization Day. In 2012, he was awarded an honorary Doctor of Letters degree by the University of the West Indies, Cape Hill campus.
In recognition of his involvement in sports, on November 26, 2019, the Kia Shepherd KFC Iwosu Market National Primary School Road Tennis Competition launched the opening of the Dr. Anthony Gabby Carter Heritage Road Tennis Heritage Center at KFC Warrens. November 30, 2019, he received a top honor from the government of Barbados, that of His Excellency the Most Honorable Anthony Carter.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, give it up as we welcome the mighty Gabby to the stage.
Queen competition, and You know, she's won it on a number of occasions, and I would like Alleyne School to give her, in her absence, a big applause because she's doing it again for us. Now, thank you so much. Recently, I lost one of my closest friends. His name is Richard Dick Stowe, but our nickname for him was Apu. Apu Stowe for 47 straight years put on the Richard Stowe Teen Talent Competition. And about 3 weeks ago, because of his illness, he wasn't able to attend, but they had a streaming and he was able to see the show from at home. And he passed away a few days ago. And, you know, we got to miss him a lot because he was my schoolmate. He wasn't just my fellow entertainer. We walked to school every day. And he was just special. I mean, really. Richard was generous. Generous where contestants, unfortunately, they didn't have the money to buy the clothes or to pay the bus fare or whatever, he would take it out of his own pocket so that they could come and make sure they got home afterwards and all. He was just amazing. And I personally believe that he should have been given our country's highest honor, because if you could do something like work with young people for 47 straight years out of your own pocket all the time, you got to be a special person. And, you know, the amphitheater at the Botanical Gardens will be called the Richard Stowe Amphitheater. Right away, I think it has already been named that. But he was also a good sportsman. He was my cricket captain at school. And let me give you a joke. I went, and I was number 4 or 5 batsmen in the St. Leonard's team. And Richard was the captain. And I got put off the team by Richard. Guess for what? Can you guess? No. I got put off the team for wearing wrong socks. Seriously, you're supposed to wear white socks at cricket, but I did not change my socks. So I kept on my school socks, with khaki socks or khaki socks. And Richard pretended to be a school inspector. And this is how he looked. He lined us off like that. And look at Richard. When he got to me, "Where is your white socks?" I said, "Well, I didn't get a chance to change, you know, like I was running late and like this guy." "Mr. Lawrence, he is off." I said, "Richard, you put me off for socks?" Richard said, "This cricket plays from up here first, and the other thing is the attire, and then the next thing is the actual play. And you violate one of the rules. The rules is you must wear white socks." But I used to see him wear white shoes all the time. And as a matter of fact, there is a thought out there that at Richard's funeral that we are asking people to wear white socks. And so, in his absence, in his passing, Alleyne School, give Richard Stowe a big, big, big applause. Now, thank you so much. He really deserves it. Now, we are celebrating for how many years? 57 years? Yeah. Well, as if you're thinking, just because Richard Stowe was 47, you would say the same 47? No, you would say the correct thing, 57. But that was a long journey. A long journey. And a lot of our history is really not history. It is his story. What is it? His story. The story he told us. Now, for example, you'll find people talking about the bearded fig tree. That they call Barbados, Los Barbados, excuse me, because of a bearded fig tree. That is not true. You see, the Africans were coming here for hundreds, if not thousands of years. And they used to wear beards. So when the Portuguese saw these people in and amongst what they call Indians, not Indians, they're just native people. They call those black people Los Barbados, meaning the ones with the beard, the bearded ones. Now, I want to take you on a long journey in a short time. The one country that we must pay homage to is Egypt. Why Egypt though? Years ago, Egypt was called Kemet. What was the name? Kemet. K-E-M-E-T. Okay? And they gave us all seven liberal arts. Namely, mathematics, science, biology, astronomy, astrology, music, and linguistics. Okay? Egypt. The African continent gave us most of everything because we were the first people on this earth. White people came from us, or what do you call white people? Caucasians. The Ethiopians gave us first university. The University of Timbuktu. So that they were so advanced that when they were at university, the Caucasians were still living in mountains, caves, and trees, and stuff like that. And the University of Timbuktu was established. And when I was a boy, because we did not understand the importance of Timbuktu, my mother, my grandmother, and them would say, "But you know, she getting on. She must think she come from Timbuktu." Meaning, in a sense, a place of backwardness. When in fact, it was a place of high education because it was the world's first university. Now, forward many years, and here are the Egyptians traveling west into West Africa and gave us drums. They gave us flute, as I saw one of you. By the way, give those youngsters a big applause for me that play that music. They gave us all these instruments, but especially the drum. And so many people were captured. And I want you to remember this for the rest of your life. No, say after me, no slaves came to Barbados. Repeat it. No slaves. Let me tell you why I say that. There is a difference between when people are captured and when they are enslaved. Now, when we came here, we were then enslaved. And you have to ask the question, how do you enslave a people? Simple. Three things. You take away their culture, you take away their religion, and you take away their language. None of us here speak an African language. But if you went to Africa tomorrow, in particular where I've been, which would have been Ghana, and Nigeria was made a chief, Botswana and so on, those are the places in South Africa that I saw, you would see people looking exactly like you. As a matter of fact, when I was in Ghana, I went up to a man, and he said, "Hey Vic, how you going, man?" I said, "How you know me? And that is not my name." I said, "You're not Victor?" "No, but who are you?" I said, "Gabby, hey, from Barbados like you." "Barbados, where is that?" I said, "In the Caribbean." "Jamaica." I said, "No, not Jamaica, Barbados." "They have other islands." "Yes, I did not know." Right, and we carried on a conversation, and I was able to tell him about Barbados. But he looked exactly like a man in no hair in Barbados. There's a good reason for that. When we were captured, we had to make the trip on the ship. And those people were so wicked that one of the names of one of the main boats, do you know what the name was? The Jesus. That was the name of one of the slave ships. The Jesus. Can you imagine that? So I want you to understand the trip that we made. And then we came here. And we had to toil for years and years. Free. Free. And one of the biggest plantations in Barbados is called Drax Hall. It's still there. It's still owned by the Drax family. There's a man called Richard Drax, whom we are insisting not only that he pays reparations, but that plantation be given to the people of Barbados, Drax Hall. Just never forget the name Drax Hall. Richard Drax is the richest person in the British politics today. He is an elected member of the British House of Commons. And he is doing his best not to pay reparations and not to give us Drax Hall. But believe you me, Drax Hall will be, maybe not in my lifetime, in the hands of y'all. Because your great, 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 great grandparents worked for free on that plantation. And not only that, but the treatment was so horrible that the age, you know what the average age of a slave when he died on Drax Hall plantation? 21. 21. That's maybe 5-6 years older than most of you are there. The treatment was horrible. And that's why we insisted that Richard Drax pay reparations. His family was here since 1645. Right? But I want you to understand the truth. And the drum was banned throughout the length and breadth of slavery. Not only here, but in the United States. There was a reason. The Africans were very smart. They did some amazing things. You would see your hair and my hair like this. The Africans used to walk with rice and peas in their hair to plant so they wouldn't starve. And secondly, those beautiful designs that you see on our hair. And please, grow your hair natural. That straightener don't belong to you. Grow it natural. Because you are Africans born in Barbados. They used to do this twisting and all this plaiting. And it used to be maps in their hair showing the others how to escape from the plantation. That's how smart. So when you see that hairstyle, it isn't just a hairstyle for them. It was maps. They would sit and plait that hair. And show slave after slave how to escape. Not only that, I'm talking about the drum. They were able to communicate with the drum. Just as how we communicate now on WhatsApp and Instagram and Facebook, they could play that drum and send a message to the next plantation. And as usual, one of our people sold us out. He goes up to the plantation owner. Ah, Masa. You see when they play the drum like that. They are not just playing the drum. They are sending a message to their friends and their family on the next plantation. And the white man, of course not. It's impossible. No, it's not impossible. Can you do it? Yes. Ba-ba-ba-ba. It is my sister. She says the baby has born and she is okay. What? got smart. The same way how they could do that, they could plan how to overthrow us. There are more of them than us. So that drum is going to be banned through the length and breadth of slavery. And it is bad. Not only here, but in the United States. I want you to understand a little connection here. Do you know that North Carolina, South Carolina, and Virginia, the first seven governors of Virginia itself, were all Barbadians? So we colonized the United States from right here. Not in Bridgetown, but Spikestown. Spikestown was the capital of Barbados and not Bridgetown. But many years ago, all back in the 1640s, there was a man called Kofi. What was his name? They call him Kofi because the British did that deliberately. But there are no Ghanaians with the name of Kofi. Kofi, K-O-F-I. And he, long before Bassup, was planning how to take over this country for the Africans. Not just to free the slaves. A lot of people say Bassup tried to free the slaves. Bassup was trying to rule the country, and rightly so. And Kofi before him. And what did they do? Two little boys went and told their mother, "We are going to take over Barbados in a few days." And I said, "What? We are going. Kofi is going to become the king of Barbados. We already built the school for him. And we are going to take over Barbados from the British in a few days." She got frightened and goes to one of the British soldiers and tells him, "Please spare my children's lives because they're planning to take over the country." We don't know if the lives were spared or not, but we know that they held Kofi, what they call Kofi for now, but we know it was who? Kofi. They tied him up in Spikestown. And they said, "Anybody who knows any of the others that were planning to take over this island, let us know those names. And you will be treated well." And one guy, Jackie, said, "Do not tell them one single name of anybody that was planning to take over this country." And the man who was doing, getting ready with the burning of Kofi, he said, "You too will get roast." And he made a famous statement. He said, "If you roast me today, you can't roast me tomorrow. Don't let them fool you. Let them roast me and let them roast Kofi." Yes. And they roast Kofi alive. They burned him alive in spite of stuff. And our family who were enslaved asked for the ashes so they could carry out a traditional burial. And the British said, "No, no, no." And they took the ashes and threw them in the sea in Spikestown. So they never got the chance to give him a respectful and proper burial. And that's why we are asking, just as we have monuments and statues for other heroes, that one for Kofi be established in Spikestown. And I want you all to help me with that, to keep telling the authorities that we need a monument, a statue, or something for Kofi, because he is indeed a national hero, just as Bassup, just as Clement Payne, and all the others. Now, that journey from Africa, Ghana in particular, there is a place I held house that I saw in Ghana where they used to keep all people downstairs, and they had a church upstairs, and they would be up there praying, thanking God that they got the chance to enslave our ancestors. Can you imagine that? Upstairs they're keeping church, and downstairs is the hell hole they're holding you. This is the last place before you went on the boat. And in Nigeria, I went on a replica of the boat that will go to the big boats. In the same year that I became a chief. And it was hurtful because I had to walk on a beach in a place called Badagry, of which I was also made a chief. But I respect that, but the people of Elara made me a chief. And I was grateful. Why? Because we have Elara Court. And when the governor's wife was building Elara Court, Miss Carter, they asked her, why you call it Elara Court? And she said, because it reminds me of Elara in Nigeria, in Africa. So you must learn these things, because the history that you are being taught is sometimes history and not history. And we walked with our drums, and the drums were banned, like I told you, for the length and breadth of slavery, not only here, but in the United States. And then they had Papova on the plantations. And then when Papova was over, finished, drum band and everything, they brought it back. And in the 1970s, they brought back Papova. Not for us, but for tourists. But it became so big, so powerful, they had no choice but to make it a national festival. And so did they all, could enjoy the proper music by many artists who were so outstanding every single year. Because every year they produce new songs, new songs, new songs. For you to dance and enjoy yourselves and be happy at proper. And so, over the years, we've had outstanding custodians like Charma, Sivers, Sudan, Lord Radio. I can go on and on right up till our time, like Romeo, Viper, Destroyer, Rhino, Red Plastic Bag, Mikey, Edwin Yearwood, Lil Rick. You know the whole set, you know. Peter Ram and so on, right? Allison Hines. I could go on and on. And I want to thank you all very much for paying such rapt attention to this little speech that I give you. But look, thank you. But before I go, I don't know if I have any music for it. I gotta let them play the song. I'm not gonna name no song. I can just let, I will call him the DJ for now. Give him a big applause to the DJ to play the song. And when they play the song, I will sing the song. You ready? We got it. Bomber. Ah, yeah. Chicken and ram. Ah! Hey! Now we have a part in this song that says Old MacDonald had a farm, and you say E-I-E-I-O. Yeah.
conscience. Sometimes good, sometimes bad, sometimes a night, Christmas day.
They gave them permission that they can record it, but I can do my own version of Young Brother. This is the original, this is the original. So let's go, DJ, and give them a little of a song called Dr. Cassandra.
Thank you.
so much. I want to do a verse of one of our songs. Can you do that? DJ, the next song.
This is what I'm gonna do with your music teacher. You tell